No, I told you to restart it. You said you did, but you didn't. Technically, you're correct, and you probably even have the data to back it up. But now you've tipped me off on the phone, so you didn't really win. And in that case, you probably did want the customer to be happy, so that's not very helpful. The reason I put this up here is I would argue that it is a hybrid of both of them. When you think about the customer is the reason you're there. So the reason I get to teach is because there are students, right? So the reason I get to be the server is because there's a customer coming to eat at my restaurant. The reason I get to have a help desk call is because there's somebody calling. And so when we think about it as, not like I'm, it's an obligatory thing, it's not that, but that is the center, that's the reason. So when I'm a parent because I have a child. Whose interest do I care about? I care about the child's. I want them to grow up to be responsible people or whatever, so that's what I want. So as a customer service person, I want the customer not just to be happy, I want them to have their solution. I want it to be fulfilled. I want them to like the experience. I want them to come back. So as the customer service person, I need to think about it from their perspective. So in a sense, they're the one that matters. Are they always right? No. But are they the one that I should be thinking from their perspective? Yes. That would be my argument. Does that make sense? And when we think about, we won't go into a bunch of it today, but there are a lot of studies about keeping and retaining customers versus getting new customers. And I'm totally going to make these numbers up. I don't know if these are true. But Liberty knows how much it costs to get you to come to Liberty. So let's say before you came, that they spent $500 to get you to Seafall, to send marketing, all the 5,000 things they send in the mail, whatever, to call you. So they had hired people to call you and check on your financial check-in. They had somebody processing your transcripts before you got, or whatever. So I'm just making this up. Let's just say it's $500 to recruit a student. Then the next semester, it didn't cost anywhere near $500 to keep you, because we already did all that. Now, it might cost me $25 to process some of your stuff in the back and to call you and say, hey, you didn't do financial check-in. Are you still planning to? Great, let's get you through that or whatever. But I could spend $500, or I could spend the second semester, let's say $25. But if you don't come back, now I'm spending $500 to get you here. And if you don't come back, now I'm spending $500 to get you. So I've got $500 every time I replace a customer, or I've got $25 just to those kinds of numbers are actually accurate. So again, is the customer always correct? No. But does it matter to keep the customer? Yes. Because it's a lot less cost to retain. That make sense? Okay. So just a review here. We talked about these the other day. In my experience, number two is the one that will separate you from the pack. Most people will do number one. I've never seen somebody in customer service go, oh, I have to be nice. Like, that's not a problem. People get that. This one will make you truly successful. This is like the final stuff. But that second one is the big one. And I am convinced, just from a lot of hiring and a lot of different departments or whatever, that most people don't think about that second one. And the people who do, and what that really means is, not that I'm just always sending you maps to make sure that you know where you're going. It's not all about just information, but that I'm thinking of from your perspective. Would you find this awkward? Would you feel like you didn't know what you needed before you got there? Is there some way that I can make you feel more at ease? If you start thinking like that second one, I think you will be surprised. Okay.
Connie.
Yes.
Question.
Oh, yeah.
I think that awkwardness thing is a cool one, because like I remember one time my boss took me into the office to talk to me, and I was like really scared. And she was, but it was a good thing because they can monitor the calls and they can hear like how we talk. And she took me in there and she was talking to me how good it was I was on the phone,
yeah.
Because there was a lot of times where I'd answer a call and I had to like, I don't know, like reset a password or something like that. And so there was that moment where I had to like do all the stuff with the headset and they're kind of quiet. But instead of just staying completely quiet with them, just kind of awkwardly on the phone, I'd be like, so. I'd like kind of like say something involving a lot of people like coffee. So I'd be like, so have you had your coffee yet this morning or something like that?
Yes.
And just keep the conversation going. And I think that was, she like really liked that. And so I thought it was cool. Just kind of like just stream of con, just going with the flow and like just talking.
That is a great example. People don't like silence.
Yeah.
And especially if I'm on the phone, I can't even see you. And I'm like, hello, you still there? You got something, whatever. It just feels awkward. So that's good. Chit chat. Excellent.
A lot better than the awkward music.
Yeah. Hey, you know what? Let me put you on call and I'll be back.
Well, I can't stand that.
Okay. Okay. Very cool. All right. So Seth Godin is an author that I have been a big fan of for years. I've probably read about 15 of his books. He writes a lot about marketing. And I think he's got a lot of really interesting concepts. Let me read this here. The complaining customer does not want a refund. He wants a connection, apology, some understanding. He wants to know why you made him feel stupid or ripped off or disrespected and why it's not going to happen again. If you have a department that sends out form letters and refund coupons, what you've done is built the ability at scale to get rid of people who are giving you a second chance. When the refund of the broken M&Ms or the artificially flavored nuts that should have been delicious or the $20 inconvenience fee in exchange for the torture you put a frequent flyer through arrives, you basically send a form letter that says goodbye, which is your choice, of course. But if you think that that expression of goodwill is going to be seen as goodwill, you're wrong. Try candor or inviting them to an online focus group. Perhaps try being human. Try giving them a chance to be a voice of the concerned, energetic customer, a voice that needs to be heard by people who actually make decisions. We live in a society that does coupons. We love coupons. So you're mad at me, whatever, and I go, okay, well, whatever. Here's a coupon. If you buy $50 worth of something, I'll give you, you know, $5 off. That may not be something you're excited about. You're like, I'm kind of mad at you. Why would I want to come spend $50 more to get 10% off? Like, that doesn't necessarily fly. And also, if you look at that second paragraph about the second chance, if I leave your establishment and I think it was a horrible experience, but I'm not saying anything to you, I just don't really want to talk to you about it. I'm not going to cause a fuss, not do anything. I just leave. So I leave, but my mom calls me. And I go, you won't believe what happened today. And so now I'm bad now in your establishment. And maybe even I go on social media, stay away from such and such. Awful service. So now I'm trashing you. My friends in a week say, let's go over there to eat. And I go, I'm not going there anymore. You know what happened last time I went there? So I never said anything to you. I just left. But what am I doing? One, you've lost me. And two, you probably have this reputation problem now because I'm running my mouth or I'm on social media or whatever it is. So what he's saying is, it's actually a good thing if you came back into the establishment and said, that really wasn't a very good experience because I had this problem and this problem. Now, none of us as humans like to be told the bad news. So at the end of the semester, you do your faculty evaluations. I can tell you, every one of us get on and go, how bad is it going to be? And when students say, I really didn't care for that class, or I thought this was hard, or whatever, we don't like that feedback. None of us do. You don't like it, right? You get your paper back, and somebody says, this isn't written well. Oh, I don't want that. But truthfully, as a business person, if you come in and give me negative feedback, instead of just walking away quietly, which makes me feel warm and fuzzy, but in truth, now I can't fix anything, if you come back and tell me with a genuine spirit, and I have the opportunity to say, really? That's not acceptable. And I do something about it. And something more than just, here's a coupon, whatever. Next time you come, you can have a free drink. Which costs me like 10 cents. But you have to spend money to buy a dinner. Like, that's not really helpful. But if I take it more of, I really want you to come back, and I want to hear what happened, I want to, like, could you participate in this focus group? Because I actually try to figure out why students are unhappy with my class. Or whatever. Now I've got a way where I'm actually drawing in the information that I can do something with, and I'm making you feel heard. Thoughts? Anything in there you had really not thought about that way before?
No, sometimes I want to refund.
Probably want the refund, but I'm going to guess you want more than that. You're happy just to get the money? It doesn't matter?
I mean, it depends on the circumstance.
Want to be acknowledged?
It depends on the circumstance. Here, like, one thing is, I have a pink phone. I didn't order this. It's an iPhone. 7 Plus with 32 gigabytes, and it's rose gold. And I ordered 128 gigabyte that was black. And essentially what happened is the guy who shipped it to me accidentally put the wrong phones in the wrong boxes, and he shipped both out at the same time. So he also couldn't give me the right phone if I did return it.
Okay.
And there was no offer of like, well, here's some money back because it's not what you ordered or anything like that. He said, like, you can return it, but then I was going to have to spend more money on getting a different phone from someone else. And I was just like, you know what, I'll just keep it, whatever. But I'm not buying from there again. So there's an online website that my mom recommended to me. Yeah. Also, probably not going to be listening to my mom's recommendations.
Well, she's a lawyer. She can get you to get the money back.
Which, interesting enough, that you're kind of proving the point. If they had fixed it and heard you and apologized.
Well, they did apologize.
Made it right. I agree. In a situation like that, you want the phone fixed. You want the right one. I got it. But my point is, I just heard you say, I'm not buying from them again. I'm not talking all along about this anymore. You know, whatever.
Yeah.
So,
I mean, they were very nice about it and everything.
They just couldn't make it right.
There's, like, it's still not the right phone. And it's pink.
I like pink stuff.
I mean, that's great, but, like, I don't. You can trade if you don't have a pink phone.
I used to have a pink phone. When I got the new one, they didn't have the rose gold and the pink one, so I had to go with the black one.
You got the last one.
Oh, great.
That's funny. All right. What are we doing on time? We are right on time today. I am going to set you up for one more video, but I want to tell you what it is first.
Good for you.
So going back to what we were talking about a few minutes ago, the era of measuring has been really, really prevalent in businesses, all kinds of industries. It doesn't just have to be what we think of as traditional business or whatever. So the guy we're going to listen to today actually is speaking about healthcare. And he's going to give you an example of two different nurses and how they approach their job. In both cases, they did everything quote unquote right. But one of them was more of this service industry idea. I did this. I did it by the script. And at the end, I said, is there anything else I can do for you? The other one approaches it from what I would consider a true customer service experience. So he's going to give a good example of this. It goes about, I think it's 17 minutes. Yeah, 17 minutes. You'll be out on time. Please listen to this. If you heard nothing I said this week, I think this video is worth it. I really do. I think if you grasp what he's getting at, it's a way of thinking. It's not a bunch of check boxes. I think it'll be worth it. I will be back later in the semester to talk about some other stuff, but